Hello, I'm Rob Brock and I work at KDAB. Welcome back to our mini-series about designing your first embedded Linux device. In this episode, we're going to talk about choosing your software stack. Deciding on the various software components in your stack is a crucial step when creating your first embedded Linux device. You want to build a stack that meets your objectives now and brings continued value in the future. However, there are so many tools you can combine to build and maintain a successful product, it can be a bit difficult to know where to start. So, in case you haven't watched the previous episode, we briefly touched on choosing a UI framework there. In this episode, we're going to discuss where to get your operating system and suggest options for managing any time-critical needs that your application may have. We'll discuss file system considerations and finish with a segment on application architecture. The foundation of all your software choices is going to be the operating system. Given the title of this series, we expect that you are considering some kind of embedded Linux. But where do you get it? There's a good chance that your board vendor provides some kind of pre-built operating system. However, you always need to check that these are suitable for use in production. Often, they are not, because the OS is unlikely to be well secured. The point of these pre-built operating systems is to allow you to quickly get set up with the vendor's hardware, and they often enable everything the hardware is capable of. When it comes to production, you should be aiming for a well-secured operating system which provides the minimal subset of hardware features your product requires. On the other hand, your board vendor may provide their own software platform which is explicitly designed for use in production. This might include an operating system that is already secured and set up for hassle-free over-the-air updates. The downside, unfortunately, of these products is that they might have more limited customization options. However, if it is customization you need, then there is a very good chance that your board vendor provides a Yocto layer or a build root configuration which you can use to build your operating system from the ground up. For your first embedded Linux project though, it might be prudent to avoid this approach because it can be a lot of work with a steep learning curve. If you can get away with it, a good way to get your product off the ground is to simply package your software or build it into a container for consumption by an existing production-ready OS. One corner case where you might consider a non-Linux OS is when your product has time-critical needs for responding to certain stimuli. In these cases, one option is to use a real-time operating system. These operating systems give you deterministic control in managing time-critical devices. They're all POSIX compliant, so while they aren't technically Linux and will have some specialized commands, tools, and APIs, in general, they have a Linux-like feel and should compile most Linux-compatible source without trouble. If only part of your application requires time-critical control, you could consider running both an embedded Linux and a real-time operating system in a hypervisor. These days, it is also becoming common for silicon vendors to bundle a separate, less powerful processor along with the main processor. This gives you the option of running your time-critical code on this separate processor, whilst running your embedded Linux on the main processor. Once you've chosen your operating system, the next building block for the software stack is going to be the file system. There are many aspects of your products that will affect and be affected by your choices. For example, from a hardware point of view, you need to consider how much space you need, how fast you might need your storage to be, and how long it should survive. From a software point of view, you need to think about the structure of your file system. For example, your update strategy might require four partitions. A and B partitions so that your updates can get installed on one while still preserving the previous working version on the other. You might require a data partition to preserve user data, and a service partition, which might be used to rescue your device if something really goes wrong. You should consider which parts of your file system should be writable, and which type of file system is appropriate for the intended use of each volume. Finally, for this episode, let's briefly discuss application architecture. At KDAB, we have decades of experience with software development, so if there's an application architecture you can think of, we've probably seen it. One of the most basic tenets of software development that we try to adhere to is keep it simple. Simple is easy to work with, easy to maintain, and easy to learn. You should keep this in mind when designing the application architecture for your product. For example, it might be tempting to go straight for some kind of fancy microservice-based architecture with all the bells and whistles. But if your team is small or your product is fairly simple, you need to keep in mind that you could be adding unnecessary complexity to your product. Only add layers of complexity or abstraction when there is a clear need and a tangible benefit. With good software development best practices, it should be straightforward to refactor your application architecture at the point it becomes worthwhile. That's it for this episode. In the next episode, we'll look at the development environment. Thanks for watching, and don't forget, there is a link to the print version of this mini-series in the description, and links to our website where you can reach out if you have any questions or need help at any point in your embedded Linux journey. I'll see you next time.